CityLeap is a world-first approach to decarbonisation at city scale. Bristol City Council has set ambitious targets to become carbon neutral by 2030. To achieve this, we need to increase the pace to decarbonise our economy and support sustainable growth, whilst demonstrating leadership in Bristol to address the climate emergency. We've procured a private sector partner to form a joint venture with the Council that is focused on strategically delivering decarbonisation projects over a 20-year period, enabling £1 billion of investment into Bristol through low-carbon energy infrastructure projects. I have been working on Bristol City Leap for the past 5 years, leading the Council through the legal elements of the procurement and negotiations with bidders. I manage the day-to-day relationship with our strategic partner and act as intelligent client for the projects being proposed through Bristol City Leap. City Leap is an innovative approach, but it grew out of climate action previously taken by Bristol City Council against a backdrop of Bristol being a city with an active community energy scene. This helped to create fertile ground for the idea of Bristol City Leap to grow. In this film, we're aiming to explain how Bristol went about procuring the Bristol City Leap partnership and how it works. We'll be explaining some of the ways we carefully selected our partner, outlining the impact of Bristol City Leap and our future hopes, as well as showing you some of the schemes already underway.
Bristol City Council has long been a leader in climate action, responding to the concerns of our citizens about climate change. And we've played a key role in enabling the city to reduce its emissions by over 50% in the last 20 years. But I'm proud the City Council has led by example in doing that. And we've reduced our own corporate emissions by over 60% in just the last 8 years. But we recognise that we need to go further and faster to tackle climate change. And that's why in 2019, our councillors unanimously voted to support the declaration of a climate emergency for the city. We were the first municipality in the UK to do this, and with our partners set a goal for the city to be carbon neutral by 2030. And I'm delighted that we've been able to join the European Union's climate neutral and smart cities mission, working with our partners across the continent to accelerate the decarbonisation of Europe. As part of that programme, I am pleased that we're able to be a net zero pilot city, working to accelerate investment into net zero projects right across the region. We believe that the City Leap initiative is a scalable and replicable model that can be used by cities in the UK, across Europe and beyond.
The Council has let a 20-year concession to our strategic partner, Amoresco Limited, to deliver and fund low-carbon energy projects across the Council's estate. The intention is that this will then be used as a springboard and leverage to decarbonise across the city, working with residential and commercial sectors alongside local authorities and other public bodies. It's important to understand what we mean by low-carbon energy infrastructure, as that is the basis of the concession. This includes projects that increase energy efficiency, such as retrofit insulation projects, building energy management systems, and installing new building fabric. It also includes energy generation from low-carbon sources, such as solar PV, heat networks, heat pumps, and wind turbines. We're also expecting incorporation of other low-carbon technologies like electric vehicle charging points, building of battery storage, and using innovative concepts to develop a decentralised low-carbon energy market. In Amoresco, we now have a pre-procured partner, which means we can deliver projects in a faster, more efficient way. We have also established a joint venture company, Bristol City Leap, whose purpose is to originate and develop new projects. Bristol City Leap will be working in collaboration with services across the council, facilitated by a client function within the council. So how did we go about setting up Bristol City Leap? Well, as a local authority, we are subject to regulated procurement, so the legal structure had to fit within that. The first thing that we did was identify the nature of the opportunity. Looking at the things we could control, we considered what was in our estate as the starting point. We were able to use some grant funding money to conduct an initial assessment. What were our assets that we could potentially offer up? Could we gather together a big enough opportunity to tempt the private sector to come and invest in Bristol? What levers does the council have? Networks, relationships with stakeholders, experience and knowledge of the local community. What else was possible in Bristol? We put together a City Leap prospectus, which was a relatively short document outlining key opportunities for large-scale renewables, decarbonisation of our social housing estate, decarbonisation of our corporate estate, and expansion of the city's electric vehicle charging infrastructure network. A soft market testing exercise was launched with a 3-month expression of interest window. Interest was massive. We received 181 expressions of interest from organisations around the world. These ranged from individuals who were interested in decarbonisation and the future of our city, to community energy groups, to local suppliers, to international energy companies, pension funds, and investment banks. We utilised help from the Department for Trade to advertise the prospectus internationally, and then we received a lot of media coverage and over 4,000 website hits. The City Leap team began to develop a picture of what structure might be attractive to the private sector. The next stage was to develop the procurement process. Passing risk over to the private sector was a central part of City Leap, and so a concession agreement was deemed the most appropriate procurement route to follow. We also wanted to maintain competitive tension throughout the procurement to achieve the best results we could for Bristol. But we had to balance that against the resource requirements that would be needed to run a long procurement. We designed a multi-stage procurement under the concession contract regulations, which spanned a 2-year period. Key stages included a selection questionnaire, invitation to participate, invitation to tender, selection of preferred bidder, and finally, a 9-month mobilisation stage. We were successful in maintaining competitiveness with multiple bidders throughout the procurement process, right up to the selection of our final preferred bidder. This meant we spent 150 hours in dialogue, held 135 bidder meetings, and created 17 tender documents. So the process itself was a huge undertaking. However, we hope that now Bristol has been a first mover, other cities looking to replicate could do so more easily and in a shorter time period. Aside from designing an appropriate procurement process, we needed to make sure we had good internal governance processes during the procurement. Engagement and buy-in from across the council was crucial to standing up Bristol City Leap. Real success depended on having political buy-in across multiple parties and from senior officers. In terms of governance, we established a City Leap project board, and we had key attendees consisting of executive directors, our finance director, legal representation, and key politicians. We attended scrutiny briefings throughout the process, and we went to Cabinet 4 times for approvals at various stages during the procurement. The competitive element of the procurement process ended with announcing Ameresco as our preferred bidder. Ameresco are a US headquartered company who have had a presence in the UK since 2014. They are a clean tech company specialising in delivering renewable and energy saving measures for the public sector. It would be Ameresco that would be providing the low carbon energy infrastructure elements of Bristol City Leap. Ameresco brought along Vattenfall as a subcontractor to provide the heat network elements of Bristol City Leap. Vattenfall is one of Europe's largest producers of heat and electricity. They've become a key partner in helping Bristol to reach net zero. As part of the procurement, we tested financial standing, quality and social value commitments. And so we had confidence that Ameresco and Vattenfall were coming with the right kind of credentials and reputation to implement the changes we wanted to make in Bristol. So how does City Leap actually work? This diagram shows the structure that we envisaged for Bristol City Leap. We've got the council, who is the client for Bristol City Leap projects. The council's client function ensures that decision-making related to City Leap complies with the council's governance roots and is the primary representative for the council as a client. Ameresco, as the strategic partner, is the entity that has entered into the concession and who have the obligation to decarbonise both the council's estate and more widely, the City of Bristol. The council and Ameresco have together set up a joint venture company known as Bristol City Leap. demonstrating to the public a bridge between the public and private sector. Bristol City Leap's job is to originate and develop projects. The joint venture company is 100% funded by Ameresco, but is controlled and owned equally between Ameresco and the council. When we set up Bristol City Leap, the council's energy service team transferred into the joint venture. It has now more than doubled, with over 70 people working for Bristol City Leap. While setting up City Leap, we transferred ownership of our existing fledgling heat network to Vattenfall so they could continue to build out the heat network across Bristol. It was one of the most complex elements of the whole procurement, but also one of the most interesting. In return, the council recouped the monies it had invested into the heat network, and the risk of future construction and operation was passed to Vattenfall. Finally, the structure that we've set up under Bristol City Leap enables flexibility and funding for projects such as large-scale renewables to come through in special purpose vehicles for SPVs. As projects are proposed by Ameresco, this sort of flexibility will be critical to opening the door to private sector financing models. It's Ameresco's responsibility to develop and identify the funding routes for those projects. The council is under no obligation to provide capital funding for projects, but it may do so if it chooses. We often get asked whether it's a good idea to appoint one private sector partner to develop and deliver these projects. We've protected against that in the concession agreement. All projects proposed need to meet a number of preset project acceptance criteria before they are given the go-ahead. The team I lead are the gatekeepers of those criteria, providing the necessary assurance to the council in relation to the projects being proposed. If Ameresco don't meet these criteria, we will go out to procure in the usual way. We're also asked how ownership of the assets works. And the general principle is that ownership depends on how the asset has been funded and will follow where the money has come from. Vattenfall are funding the heat network build-out, so they will own the heat network assets. Where Ameresco are financing a wind turbine, that turbine will be owned by Ameresco or by an SPV, depending on the financing arrangements. Ameresco and Vattenfall are taking the risk in developing and funding the projects, and so they will generally be entitled to retain the ownership of them. We're also asked how Ameresco is making its money through the strategic partnership. Well, there are three key ways that Ameresco or any strategic partner may make their money. Firstly, for council-funded projects with a defined scope of work, there will be a traditional design and build contract with the returns made on cost pass-through plus profit margin. Secondly, where there are projects which enable a commodity sale, for example, Ameresco fund building a wind turbine or providing heat, the council or other third parties will be an off-taker of the electricity or heat through a power purchase agreement or heat network connection agreement. Thirdly, where there are defined outputs for a project funded by Ameresco, they will take their returns through energy performance contracting or energy as a service or heat as a service models. We are also asked how we are protecting the council's assets. It is important to note that we are not selling off any assets. We may enter into a lease or license to enable Ameresco to install infrastructure, but we have not sold anything other than transferring the heat network to Vattenfall. We also need to make sure we're protecting the council's assets and driving best value. It is key that Ameresco do not have an absolute right to build projects on our estate. We have not given them a blank check. As part of ensuring the council's interests are protected, we have introduced a series of project acceptance criteria, a set of checks and balances conducted by the client function, which must be met before a project is allowed to proceed. One of these key checks is value for money. We need to make sure that Ameresco and Vattenfall will not be charging us above market rates for the projects that they are installing. So what have Ameresco committed to do for the council? As part of the tender process, all bidders were required to provide a business plan, setting out what they would do through the City Leap Energy Partnership. Those bid commitments were contractualised in the concession agreement, Ameresco and Vattenfall committed to delivery of around £400 million by 2027 and around £1 billion over the course of the 20-year partnership. Bid commitments include making the council's own operational properties carbon neutral by 2025 and ensuring our social housing reaches an EPC rating of C or better by 2030. Vattenfall has committed to expand the heat network, making it carbon neutral, and to making a material reduction in carbon emissions for Bristol by 2030. We've been able to turn business plan commitments on decarbonisation into KPIs, which can be monitored with consequences if they are not met. One of the key elements of Bristol City Leap has been ensuring that we deliver a fair approach to decarbonisation across Bristol. As part of that, we have put social value at the front and centre of our procurement. We assigned a high proportion of the tender marks to social value questions. As part of their bid, Ameresco and Vattenfall committed to delivering £61.5 million of social value. This includes around £50 million of expenditure within the local supply chain. They've committed to create over 1,000 new jobs, apprenticeships and work placements, and they guaranteed that 100% of people working on Bristol City Leap would be paid at least the real living wage. In addition, they made commitments to enable the wider local community to participate in City Leap. Bristol has got an extremely active community energy ecosystem, and it was vital to us that our strategic partner understood that and brought the community groups along on the journey. Ameresco and Vattenfall have committed to creating a number of funds during the term of the concession. For example, the creation of a £1.5 million energy development fund, which can be accessed by local communities to help get energy projects started. They also committed to making 10% of non-heat network capital requirements available by public subscription through a dedicated crowdfunding platform. They estimated that this would allow crowdfunding of around £6 million in the first 5 years of Bristol City Leap. In addition to these monetary commitments, Bristol City Leap have an open door policy to enable groups and networks to share ideas and to work with Bristol City Leap to develop how community projects go forward. So, how has it been going in the first year? Well, the first 2 years we expected to be about laying the groundwork for future projects and establishing a strong way of partnership working. We knew it would be slow to start, but would quickly build up around year two onwards. In the first year, we've seen delivery of around £16 million worth of projects against a bid-in target of £23 million. A key focus for the next year is decarbonisation of the council's corporate estate. On the heat network front, within the first year, Vattenfall have delivered around 22 gigawatt hours of low carbon heat to heat network customers. They signed 7 new connection agreements and connected 2 new buildings, with more connections to come over the following months. They've achieved 99% availability of heat across the year, which is in line with their KPI commitments. In addition, they've been completing their detailed feasibility work for new areas of heat networks within the city. On the social value front, Bristol City Leap has already made some of the first grant awards through the Community Energy Fund they have established. City Leap has worked with grassroots community groups to fund and support energy initiatives. They've contributed more than 350 volunteer hours towards improving communities. The partnership has created 102 new jobs within the wider Bristol area and provided more than 50 weeks of work placements and work experience, which is fantastic. In total, this year, Bristol City Leap has spent nearly £3 million with local suppliers, voluntary community and social enterprise organisations to support the local economy and enable job creation. Bristol City Leap is working up an extensive programme of engagement with education providers, from primary schools to higher education, to upskill the city's green economy, which is really setting the foundations for the future of Bristol. So what is next for City Leap? Ameresco annually update the Bristol City Leap business plan, and the latest version had a really positive message, envisaging a delivery of around £775 million over the next 5 years. Of this, around £111 million is to be spent on decarbonisation projects on the council's corporate estate and social housing. Around £83 million is going to be invested in large-scale renewable energy projects, primarily in wind turbines and solar farms. And around £475 million of investment by Vattenfall will be into the heat network. We can see that around 2 to 3 years into the contract, Ameresco and Vattenfall are expecting to exceed the business plan that they submitted as part of their bid and perform well beyond that. As a result, Ameresco is currently anticipating that they will exceed or meet all of their KPI targets that were set in the concession. Those KPIs cover carbon saved, energy efficiency measures deployed, zero carbon energy generated, and zero carbon energy generation assets deployed. All of these forecasts and numbers in the business plan, however, are subject to caveats. We accept that the ability of Ameresco to deliver against these forecasts will be subject to unknown factors, such as general elections, the wider macroeconomic pressures, and in particular, what happens to energy prices. Also, we must remember that any projects that Ameresco set out in the business plan are still subject to relevant governance approvals by our City Council.
We believe this is the first time a strategic partner has been appointed by a local authority to decarbonise on a city-wide scale. The concept of Bristol City Leap is relatively simple. We've looked at where we have underutilised council assets and said, can we bring those together and offer them up as a substantive enough opportunity to attract the private sector? We're lucky here in Bristol that we already have a large social housing stock, as well as the beginnings of a heat network. Furthermore, we have a lot of land within an industrialised coastal area, which is ripe for putting large-scale renewable projects on. What Bristol City Council has brought to the table is not just our physical assets, but we also have lots of soft assets. Influence that can help create a strategic approach to decarbonisation across the city and ensure the growth of the city's green economy. We have our brand strength as a public body. We have strong relationships across key stakeholders and businesses and other local authorities in the region. And all of this acted as an attractive proposition to the private sector to come in and drive large-scale decarbonisation. In addition, when we were developing Bristol City Leap, we tried to create a flexible model that let the private sector tell us the answer as to how all this could be best funded. The model we've chosen allows a strategic approach to be taken to projects, providing the scale required to make the opportunity for the private sector. It enables flexibility for the right strategic partner to choose the right model for funding the projects. And it also allows us to then access non-traditional financing routes for public sector projects. Some of the models that Ameresco is proposing to use, such as energy as a service and heat as a service, have not been widely used in the UK before. We believe that Bristol City Leap is a model that is capable of replication across the UK and potentially even internationally. What we've done is take council-owned assets, brought them together, and leveraged them to create a market. We pioneered a place-based approach, and it should be possible for other local authorities to put together a similar offering. A successful partnership between the public and private sector requires both sides to take on risk. In Bristol, we had to do this in two ways. First, by investing money to set up Bristol City Leap. And then, on an ongoing basis, we have to take the risk of opening up our estate and allowing a first right of refusal to build out projects on it. Obviously, all of that is subject to appropriate protections that are managed by the client function. And our private sector partner recognised the size and certainty of the potential opportunity that City Leap offered. And that allowed them to also take on risks to get us to this point. They had to incur a lot of upfront cost to participate in the bid process. And going forward, they take on the development risks for projects. The overall size and certainty of the pipeline for City Leap justifies our private sector partner taking on those initial and ongoing risks. We think that some of the specific issues we faced here in Bristol, such as having our procurement start in the middle of COVID, of course, and the transfer of our existing heat network, made the procurement take longer and cost more than it could otherwise have been. But we think now that we've gone first, it should also be possible for other local authorities to take on board the lessons we've learned and deliver their own City Leap versions more quickly and at lower cost. It hasn't been easy for Bristol to set up City Leap. It was a long and complex process, taking around 6 years of focused efforts. But the bottom line is we've taken £9 million of seed funding and leveraged it to create a £1 billion opportunity.
It was really critical that we got a good level of commitment from our strategic partner on social value delivery and community engagement, and we really put it central to the procurement. Competition was an important part of the process. With more than one bidder, we were able to leverage our position to get strong commitments. We offered up a 20-year concession. Suppliers will not invest in Bristol if they can't see there being an ongoing pipeline of work. By offering a long-term partnership, we could guarantee a certainty of pipeline, which is critical for Ameresco and Vattenfall to secure local supply chain build-out. In terms of partnership working, communication and transparency are key. Success requires both parties to understand each other's drivers and red lines. So we tried to design the procurement in such a way that we asked the right questions to tease out whether or not the strategic partner's ethos would align with our own. It also requires continued investment into the relationship. This has to happen at all levels within the organisation, at political level, at strategic senior management level, and at more junior officer level on a day-to-day basis. When councils are considering whether a City Leap model is the right way for them to proceed to tackle their own climate targets, they shouldn't just consider the cost of doing a procurement. There need to be appropriate service level arrangements put in place to manage the contract, manage the performance of the strategic partner, manage the contractual protections, and to ensure that the council's governance routes are followed.
We really hope that what we've done in Bristol will inspire cities everywhere to accelerate their plans for decarbonisation.
What City Leap has shown is if you take the time and you listen and partner with private sector partners, you can bring all of their expertise, their innovation and their capital into your place to help with your own decarbonisation journey.
The fact that City Leap sits in between the public and the private sector, acts as an intermediate, makes everything quicker, easier and just so much better.
We've got a well-rehearsed team. The projects are thought and considered. I'm fully supported. I know exactly what I should be doing, when I should be doing it and how to do it. And I've always got that back office support.
The potential and the opportunity is huge. We provide heat to 5,000 customers in the city. Within the next 5 years, we plan to reach out to 12,000. So we're super excited by the idea of being able to extend our reach.
One of the things that attracted us is they want to use local companies like ours. We're Bristol based, we've been here for a long time. We use local suppliers, our staff are local. So we feel it's important that we can contribute to what they're doing, but also bring that business back through our community.
Bristol City Leap gives us the opportunity to build another 1,000 charge points in the city. There's so much more that we need to do to decarbonise transport, and this is a really great opportunity to achieve that.
We're really able to be holistic for Bristol City Leap. We can bring in the supply chain, we can bring in manufacturers, we can talk to communities to ensure that we're marrying up all the elements of decarbonisation in one space, and that is really what allows us to be incredibly innovative.
Bristol City Leap has been amazing. The contractors, the people you've got to get contact with to get through, everything's been amazing. As you can see now, my house looks perfect.
We're off to a brilliant start with Bristol City Leap. We're creating thousands of jobs across the supply chain. We're investing millions of pounds into community projects. And we're creating opportunities for employment and skills to bring young people forward into those green careers and green jobs of the future.
It's only through the private investment element of City Leap that we've been able to unlock the large-scale decarbonisation opportunities across the city.
The future that we all need to work towards is one where we blend private money, place-based leadership and local grassroots activists to deliver the net zero future that the world needs.
We hope that other cities will be able to enjoy the benefits that we're seeing in Bristol of investment, reduced emissions, local jobs, and improve quality of life for our citizens.